So we have a patient who has been newly diagnosed with metastatic prostate cancer, so stage 4. And their doctor told them that chemotherapy is not an option for them and that they need to go straight to a clinical trial. Their concern is that the doctor is more interested in his research than them as a patient. And so they're wondering, how do they find another oncologist that they can go to that would even put chemo on as an option?
Well, yeah, it's always hard to guess what people's motivations are for different things. It is true that doctors that have connections in academia do need to put people on clinical trials, and sometimes that motive can overshadow perhaps what might be the most appropriate for a patient. What this gentleman is talking about is a situation that got resolved in 2021, where they looked at long-term outcomes, survival in people with newly diagnosed metastatic hormone-sensitive disease. These individuals that were treated with a combination of Zytiga, which is abiraterone, Lupron, and Taxotere, did better than the patients that got Zytiga and Lupron alone, and lived substantially longer. In these studies, they doesn't mean that the patients who didn't get Taxotere never got Taxotere. It means that they got Taxotere later when the Lupron and Zytiga stopped working. So it's really immediate Taxotere versus delayed Taxotere. And this question comes up a lot in discussions with oncologists. As an oncologist treating patients, there's always a concern in the delivery of some treatment. Am I going to run out of options for this patient? Will I be faced with a day when don't have anything I can give them that would help them? And that's a common situation in the field of cancer, and it's logical that doctors may want to hold something in reserve so they can have something to give at a future date when the existing treatment stops working. Clinical trials over and over show that if you have an effective treatment that can be given safely in combination, that's not excessively toxic, that it always works better giving it up front earlier on rather than waiting until the disease develops momentum and starts to get out of control. The only reason one wouldn't do that is that as you pile one treatment on top of another treatment on top of another treatment, sometimes you'll run into excess toxicity. And then there are situations where certain individuals have such a good outlook, they don't need such intensive therapy. And that's a judgment call of the oncologist. But most people that have metastatic prostate cancer are going to develop hormone resistance at some point, and therefore will end up on Taxotere at some point. And those individuals will do better if they get the Taxotere early on, when the disease is less entrenched, as opposed to getting it later on, where it'll do some good, but it won't do as much good. So this has been answered in a randomized prospective trial. So it's not opinion anymore, it's scientific fact. And not all the doctors are aware of it. Medicine is moving quickly, and the general oncologists out there are treating 100 different types of cancer. So they're not going to be able to be up to date in every single cancer. They may not be familiar with these clinical trials yet. So how do you find an oncologist? I think you shop around, look online, see how many stars they have, if patients are happy with them. And in consulting a new oncologist, express your goals in terms of why you're consulting them. It's not just to throw yourself at their feet and say, do to me what you will, but demonstrate that you're an informed patient and that you're aware of the latest research and that you want to be treated in an optimal, modern fashion. And oncologists in general are going to be very open to giving chemotherapy. That's what mostly they do for a living.
So it's interesting, you know, this person was newly diagnosed at stage 4, and this leads me into the next question. Another patient was wondering, how aggressively should you be checking for early metastatic activity? Should you be getting scans every 6 months? Like, what's the methodology for checking this out?
PSA, of course, in the prostate cancer world is an amazingly powerful tool. And if the PSA is undetectable, whether a person had surgery, radiation, or hormone treatment, historically, we've believed that the scans are going to be clear and they're not going to really give you any additional useful information. We'll find out if that's still true with the new PSMA PET scans that have just become commercially available. That is a more powerful scan, and for the first time, we're able to see much smaller specks of cancer. And so the old rule of thumb was that if the PSA is less than 0.1, don't bother doing scans because you're not going to find anything. But that rule has yet to be proven now that we have PSMA PET scans. And I honestly don't know. There may be situations where these scans will be appropriate to find out if there's something lurking in a shadow that could be treated, even though the PSA is what otherwise undetectable.
Well, so if you have like a patient who's on maybe like a second generation androgen hormone therapy, and so they've been, you know, going strong on that, is PSA the only indicator? They don't need to get like yearly PSMA scans?
Well, that's exactly the question. I don't think we have an answer. So historically, if the PSA was undetectable, we would counsel patients that doing bone scans and CAT scans and axillary PET scans and whatnot are a waste of time. They're not going to show anything of any relevance. But we don't know that's the case with PSMA PET scans. It's really too early to say as this technology has just come out.
Considering we don't know yet, I know a lot of people are wondering if PSMA scans should be, you know, used at initial diagnosis and just to be, you know, see if they have metastatic activity. Do you think that PSMA will be something that's used at initial diagnosis in the future?
Oh, absolutely. PSMA PET scans are a cut above every other scan, more accurate, more sensitive. And the question about whether or not cancer is spread outside the prostate has always been the main issue that needs to be resolved. So when people are newly diagnosed with intermediate or high-risk prostate cancer, they'll routinely get a CAT scan and a bone scan. And sometimes these things will demonstrate something, but most times they won't. But experts know that just because the scans are clear doesn't mean there's not any small metastatic lesions out there. They just know there's no big, ugly metastatic lesions out there. But with PSMA PET scans, we're picking up much smaller spots at a much earlier stage. And I really can't imagine why in 2022 anyone would ever do another CAT scan or a bone scan. Staging process historically, which relied on CAT scans and bone scans, now I think is history. The only sensible scan to do is a PSMA PET scan. No one wants to use older, cruder technology when you've got modern, accurate technology available to certainly people that have Medicare. I know that with the PPOs and the HMOs and whatnot, there'll probably be pushback in the early utilization of these scans. But the standard of care, as far as I'm concerned, is PSMA PET scans and really no other scan. And they should be done routinely for every newly diagnosed patient that isn't a candidate for active surveillance. Men who are Gleason 6 and are doing active surveillance do not need PSMA PET scans because we know that that type of prostate cancer doesn't spread outside the prostate.
Thanks for watching. If you would like more information about prostate cancer, you can go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We come out with new prostate cancer videos every week. And go ahead and visit our website, pcri.org. We have tons of information on prostate cancer that will help you.